Welcome back to all. This is very basic lecture on quantum mechanics and atomic structure, and where in this lecture I will talk about what is called the orbitals and how the orbitals is actually looks like, and how the electron configurations of different atoms or elements can be determined using some of the basic principle. So all those things will be discussed in detail in the lecture, and I just want to remind you all that before start of this lecture, please subscribe to my channel Chembiosis. So let's start the lecture. So the concept of basically atomic and molecular structure is very important for the organic chemist also. So the all those concept of atomic and molecular structure is basically start way back in the year of 1926, where the two group of scientists, one is under the supervision of Erwin Schrödinger and another is under the supervision of Heisenberg and Paul Dirac. These two groups have developed two separate approach about the atomic and molecular structure, and the approach that is developed by the Erwin Schrödinger is basically known as wave mechanics, and the approach that is developed by Heisenberg and Paul Dirac is called quantum mechanics. Basically these two are basically nothing but they are same, only their approaches are different. So these two approaches make our understanding about the atomic and molecular structure very well defined. So the main thing, that is the core of this lecture, is basically psi. That is, psi is basically any wave function. So any wave function is basically represented by this symbol that is called psi. So what is psi, or what is wave function? So basically this psi is nothing but some kinds of equation which shows the different energy states of electron. So suppose there are several energy states are there, and electrons are occupying each of these energy states. So each of these energy states will have the different psi value, or this different equation. So this psi value actually represent the energy states of each of these electrons. So suppose there are total 5 energy states, like psi 1, psi 2, psi 3, psi 4, psi 5. So each of these energy states are defined by this symbol that is called psi. So now you can see that these energy states are having different energy, and by using the theory of quantum mechanics, that is called the Schrödinger's equation, H psi is equal to E psi, you can actually determine the energy of each of these energy states of the electrons. Okay, so the psi is nothing but the different energy states of electron, which is defined by this types of symbol, which is known as a Greek letter or psi. Okay. Now you have to know that the quantum mechanics that is developed is nothing but a probabilistic science. So previously, the before the discovery of the quantum mechanics, the main all those things are that were are developed before are basically deterministic. So in that case, you can actually determine the exact position, exact velocity, everything exactly. But in case of quantum mechanics, all those things are probabilistic. So here you cannot say that you can exactly determine the position of an atom or the momentum of an atom. You cannot exactly define, but you can say that there is some 80% or 90% probability that the electron will be there, or there is some 80% or 90% probability that the momentum of the electron is in between this value. So that's why the quantum mechanics is nothing but a probabilistic science, which is basically based on this principle that is called the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle. So according to the Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, you cannot determine the exact momentum and exact position of a particle simultaneously. So you can see this is the equation which is defined or which is known as Heisenberg's uncertainty principle, where you can see this delta p is basically the uncertainty associated in determining the momentum of the particle, and this delta x is basically associated with the uncertainty in determining the position of a particle. So you can see that the product of these two uncertainty is greater than h cross by 2. So as you can see that if you want to determine the momentum of a particle very precisely, then delta x will become very high. On the other hand, if you want to determine the position of a particle very precisely, then the uncertainty in determining momentum will become very high. So which means that you cannot determine these two values very precisely as well as very simultaneously. So from here the you can see that you can always talk about the probability of finding the momentum of a particle and position of a particle. You cannot say that we have find out the exact momentum and exact position of the particle. So this is the basic difference between the quantum mechanics and classical mechanics, where quantum mechanics is probabilistic and classical mechanics is deterministic. Okay, so you can see that the psi that I have told you previously, psi is basically defining the energy states of different electron. The probability of the finding the electron in space is also associated with this value psi. So if you can determine the psi value, you can also determine the probability associated of finding this electron in some region. So now we will talk about how this psi is look like. So you can see this is a basic functions, how this psi is look like is shown here. You can see that this psi can have both positive value as well as negative value. So it can have both positive and negative value. On the other hand, if you take the mod value of the psi and if you take the square of this mod value, then the value that you will obtain is called the probability density. So what is this probability density, that we will see in the next slide. So this is the graph of the mod value of the psi square. So as you are taking the mod value and also taking the square of it, so that's why the psi square value will always have some positive value. Like psi, it should not have any negative value. So suppose this is the function of the psi square is looking like as a function of x. Now you can see if you choose some small area that is in between x and x plus dx, so this small area dx, so the psi square into dx, so if you just multiply this psi square, that is the probability density, with dx, that is actually the probability of the finding the electron in between x and x plus dx. So this value is nothing but the probability of finding the electron in between these two region. So if you have the basic information about the psi value, you can also determine the probability of finding that electron in some certain region. So this is the interpretation that has been given by Born, and it is known as Born interpretation of wave function. So basically the only the psi value or psi value do not have any physical meaning until and unless you take the square of this psi value, that is known as probability density function, which has some meaning, because if you multiply this psi square with some element volume, that is volume element or region element, then you will obtain the probability of finding that electron in that element. So you can see that as this is the probability of finding the electron in between x and x plus dx, so if you take the integration over all the space, then you will obtain the total probability will be 1, because if you find out or if you take the probability over all the region of the space, you will always end up with 100% probability. So that's why this integral value is equal to 1. Now I am coming to the concept of orbital. So this orbital, the word that orbital you will heard many times in the organic chemistry. So before start to understood about what is this orbital, we have some basic knowledge about what is orbital. So basically orbital is nothing but a region in a space where the probability of finding the electron is maximum. So as you remember that we can always talk about the probability of finding the electron, we can, because the quantum mechanics is basically probabilistic. So that's why orbital is, you can see, is a region of space where there is maximum probability of finding the electron. So this is the shape of an s orbital. As you can see that it has some kind of spherical shape, and you can say that there is a maximum probability of the finding the electron in between this space. So that is why this region is called the orbital. And you can say that if in this space there is almost 90 to 95% probability that the electron will be there. So that's why this region has the maximum probability of finding the electron, and it is known as s orbital. Similarly, there can be other different orbital like p orbital, which is having different shape, and also there will be, and in between this region there will be 90 to 95% probability that the electron will be present. But we cannot say that there will be 100% probability, but we can say that there is 90 to 95% probability is there to find out the electron. Okay, now these are some of the shape of different types of orbital, as you can see in this picture. So this is the shape of an 1s orbital. So you can see in 1s orbital the electron is basically between this region, there is almost 90 to 95% probability of finding that electron. And you can see that there is no node is present. So what is node, that I will come in this when I will talk about the 2s orbital. So now this is the picture of a 2s orbital. Now you can see that in between these two sphere there is a nodal region. So you can see that this sphere has positive sign and this sphere has negative sign, and in between this two sphere there is a surface where the electron density is zero. So this region is called the nodal surface. So as you can see, when the in case of the or any orbital, when the psi will change its signs like this, like in when it changes like from positive to negative, there is some point where the electron density is very electron density is zero, and that space is, or that region is called the node or nodal region. So here you can see that in case of 2s orbital, so in between these two sphere there is some surface is there where the electron density is zero. So that's why this surface is known as nodal surface. Similarly, you can see that these are the two lobes of a p orbital. So the upper lobe is having positive sign and the lower lobe is having negative sign, and in between the region or in between the surface area or in between this where the two lobes are touching, the plane containing the two lobes where they are basically touching each other is known as nodal plane, where the electron density is equal to zero. So you can see that in any nodal plane or nodal surface or in a nodal point, the electron density will become zero. Now it is very important to mention that whatever the sign you are seeing here, that is positive, negative, it is not signify any charge. It is not that it is positively charged, it is negatively charged. There is no relationship of positive charge or negative charge with that sign. This sign, that you will understand that it's important when we will talk about the molecular orbital theory and hybridization theory. In those chapters you will understand the importance of the sign of these lobes of different orbitals. Okay, now I will just show how we can determine the electron configuration of some element or atom. So first of all, you have to understood that whatever the electron that is residing in 1s orbital is very closest to the nucleus. So that's why the electron that is residing in 1s orbital will be attracted very much by the nucleus. So that's why these electrons that is residing in 1s orbital will have the lowest energy. On the other hand, the 2s orbital, which is further away from the 1s orbital, or the further away from the nucleus, so that is why it has greater energy than 2s, greater energy than 1s atomic orbital. So on similarly, the 2p atomic orbital, basically there are basically three degenerate orbitals are there, like 2px, 2py and 2pz. Degenerate means that these orbitals are having the same energy, so that's why they are called the degenerate orbital. So similarly, if you go to the 3d orbital, so d orbital has total 5 degenerate orbitals. So those things you will you can read in another chapter. Okay, now you can see that suppose this is the element sodium, which is having the atomic number Z is equal to 11. So it has total 11 electron, and the electron configuration of the sodium is like this: 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s1. So by this way you can actually show the electron configuration of sodium atom. Similarly, the chromium atom, the Z is equal to 24, and the electron configuration of chromium is like this. So the question arises that how you can actually determine the electron configuration of an atom. So before deriving the how you can determine the electron configuration of atom, you have to understood three principle, basically the how you can fill up the orbitals with electrons is determining the electron configuration of an atom, and how these electrons are filled up in different orbitals is basically based upon these three principle. So the first principle is called the Aubau principle. So according to that Aubau principle, the orbital which is having the lowest energy will be filled first. So as you can see that if you go through 1s orbital, 2s orbital, 2p orbital, 3s orbital, so you can see that 1s orbital is the having the lowest energy, and after that 2s orbital having the lower energy, then 2p, then 3s. So whenever the electrons fill up, it will fill up the 1s orbital first, then it will fill up the 2s orbital, then 2p and then 3s. So electron will always filled up in the lowest energy level at first, then it will successively go to the higher energy levels. So that is called the Aubau principle. Now the second principle is called the Pauli's exclusion principle. So according to the Pauli's exclusion principle, you cannot place more than 2 electron in any orbital. So in any orbital, maximum 2 electron can be placed, and moreover these 2 electron should be placed with different spin or opposite spin. So as you know that electrons are orbiting around the nucleus, and also electron is rotating around its own axis. So there are basically two types of rotation around its axis is possible. One is called the clockwise rotation, and another is anti-clockwise rotation, and that's why this spin value has two number, the two possible numbers. So for clockwise rotation it has value plus half, and for anti-clockwise rotation it has value minus half. So this value is known as spin quantum number, or ms. So ms can have always two value, that is plus minus half for electron. So that is the thing we discussed in Pauli's exclusion principle, that in any single orbital maximum 2 electron can be placed, and if they are placed, they cannot be placed with same spin, they have to be placed with opposite spin maintained. So this is called the Pauli's exclusion principle. The third rule, that is called the Hund's rule. So I will just give an example to make you understood what is called the Boone's rule. So suppose you have three orbitals, three degenerate orbitals, and four electrons. Now the Boone's rule will decide how the electrons will be placed in these three degenerate orbital. So at first the electron will be placed separately. So suppose there are three degenerate orbital, at first three electrons will be placed separately. So at first they will not sit together. Then whatever the electron left out will pair with one of this electron. So this is called the Hund's rule. So by using this Hund's rule, this is because there if the electron configuration will be like this, in that condition there will be maximum electrostatic repulsion in between the electron. So the Hund's rule is ensure that the electrostatic repulsion between the electron should be as minimum as possible. So that's why these types of pairing will occur with minimum probability. So at first they will be, the electron will be placed unpaired, and then whatever the electron will be left out will paired with any one of this electron. So this is called the Hund's rule. Now you can see these are some of the electron configuration of different elements. So I will just give some example. Like for boron, as you can see, boron has total 5 electrons. So as you can see that the energy levels, as you can see that 1s is having the lowest energy level, and after that 2s, and after that 2p. So according to the Aubau principle, the lowest energy level will be filled first. So that's why the 1s orbital is filled first, then the 2s orbital will be filled first, and after that the 2p, that is having the highest energy state, will be filled at the last. So whatever the remaining electron that is that present will be filled in the highest energy orbital, that is called the 2p orbital in case of boron. And as you can see that any one of this orbital, maximum two number of electrons are placed, that is called the Pauli's exclusion principle. And as you can see that they are placed with opposite spin. So they are not placed like this, so they are placed like the opposite spin. So this is called the Pauli's exclusion principle, which is followed while the electrons are filled in 1s orbital as well as 2s orbital. Now come to the example for carbon atom. So carbon atom, there is one electron more, so it has total 6 electron. So first of all, 1s and 2s orbital will be filled up like the according to the Aubau principle and Pauli's exclusion principle. Then whatever the two electrons left out will be filled in the 2p orbital. So similar thing occur in case of nitrogen, where the third electron goes to the 2p orbital. So here you can see that while the 2p orbital is filled up, it is following the Hund's rule, that is the electrons are filled up unpaired. So that's why there will be minimum repulsion between the electrons. So they will at first filled up unpaired. So now in case of oxygen, whatever the extra electron, that will be paired with one of this electron. So you can see that in oxygen, the fourth electron in the 2p orbital is paired with one of this electron. So similarly in case of fluorine, the fifth electron in the 2p orbital is paired with one of this electron. And this is the electronic configuration of the neon, and you can see that neon has closed shell electron configuration, where all the electrons are paired in each of this orbital. So you can see that by using the three rule, that is Aubau principle, Pauli's exclusion principle, and Hund's rule, we can actually determine the electron configuration of each of this atom or elements. So this is the lecture up to this, and if you have any doubts or questions, you can ask me through the comment section. And in the next lecture, I will talk about the concept of molecular orbital theory and the concept of hybridization in my next lecture. So till then, take care of yourself. Bye.